for the, thank you for the Fall Festival. And there was a note at the very end of that, if you need sweetening, come by my office, we've got plenty of candy left over, okay? So that y'all can get it, so me and Brian don't eat it all. That's right, okay? Let's go, let's stand up as we sing. On Christ the solid rock I stand.
Sad. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 27. The word of the Lord says, as Jesus speaks, "Now my soul has become troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came out of heaven, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." So the crowd of people who stood by and heard it were saying, "It thundered." But others were saying, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered and said, "This voice has not come for my sake, but for your sakes. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself." Father, we thank you for this work of redemption that you have done. We thank you that in the midst of all kinds of things that go on by your permissive will, as we as human agents have free will granted us within boundaries, we're so grateful that your sovereign will ultimately be accomplished. But for those of us who are your children, the good, the bad, whatever of our life that happens, you have given us a promise that you will use all of those things to conform us to the image of your Son. And so, again, we thank you for all of that. Lord, we pray that you would be with each person right now whose heart is filled with concern, fears, troubles, people who have great questions and need answers, those who are dealing with medical concerns of all kinds. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that you would bring healing, that you would bring answers, that you would bring peace as the Prince of Peace. Lord God, can we just say thank you again for the fact that you have put your Spirit within us as born-again children of God, so that no matter what we face in this life, we'll never face it alone. In Jesus' name we pray.
Save.
time you sing that song, you sing that chorus, I can't help but remember as a little kid, we learned God. And it seems kind of like a simple song, but it is oh so true. We go through life and we think, man, things are just not going my way. Then you sit back and look, well, wow, things could be a whole lot worse. Right? Yes, absolutely. Randy Ray saying, I can see now. All right, you know, he got those, things can always be worse. But God has been so good to us. And in our, I think our response comes in our next song. Come let us adore him, behold our King. Nothing can compare. Come let us adore. Let us stand as we sing, behold our King.
Kings and nations tremble.
Heavenly Father, we understand you are on your throne. Today and every day. Father, we don't acknowledge you as Lord, Savior, Creator, Giver, Sustainer, Provider. All those functions that you have in our lives. Father, we just want to keep you honored this morning. Father, we want to adore you for all that you've done and all that you are. Father, just thank you so much for your love, your grace, and your mercy. And Father, you say you will never leave us nor forsake us. Even when we think things are really going bad, but Father, you are there with us all along the way. Father, thank you so much for that promise. Father, we ask as we open your word today that you'll give us words of encouragement, words of truth to stand on. But most of all, give us something that we can go out and share with our neighbor. Father, we ask all these things in your holy name.
Good to see all of you, either non-deer hunters or finished deer hunters or deer hunters that took a break. It's good to have y'all here. Pray for those other folks as they're out there and they'll be safe. A lot of people have just been trying to process the election and kind of what's going on. And can I say, a lot of us suffer because we don't remember the constitutional process. And so we understand that the election will not be concluded until December the 13th. Constitutionally speaking, the Electoral College meets December the 13th. It is at that time that they will turn in their votes by state, and that will be when the election is complete. So please keep that in mind. Do you have anything to pray about between now and December 13th? Well, even beyond that. And so it pays in a lot of ways to know some things about our own governing system. Unfortunately, we're not teaching our children civics and government and that sort of thing anymore. And so they come up with the idea that we're just a simple democracy. And that's just not the case. We're a constitutional republic that is based on a democratic process. Okay, so having said that, let's talk about the permissive will of God and what does sovereignty mean? And I'm wearing this phone. I'm going to get in trouble with Sarah already. She says, I can hear your phone in the microphone. So put that over there. But y'all don't let me forget where I put it because I'll be looking everywhere. Does the permissive will of God mean something detrimental to the sovereignty of God? Does sovereignty mean that everything that happens is God's perfect will? And of course, as I hear people talking about the election, I hear comments from time to time like, well, if that's how it turned out, that must have been God's will. And although I you know, something inside of me wants to rise up a little bit, I say, okay, yes, God's permissive will. So let's talk a little bit today about how that works, because it's important for us to understand. Otherwise, we might be somewhat confused about what God is up to. If you look at Luke chapter 22, you see a passage where there's a dispute in terms of the disciples foolishly trying to decide which one of them is going to be the greatest, you know? It's like a little old Muhammad Ali meeting of the disciples, you know, who's the greatest? But in the process, he says to them, kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who have authority over them are called benefactors. And by the way, be wary of the fact that when you have a sense of government where they say that they're the benefactors, that they're going to give you everything that you need and that sort of thing. Because our unalienable rights don't come from government. Our unalienable rights come from where? God. And so ultimately, God is the one who knows what we really need, and He is the only true benefactor. There are only people who may work alongside with God or may work in opposition to God to replace Him as benefactor, that they might have control over the people that they govern. Well, it goes on to say, but it is not this way with you. But the one who is the greatest among you must become like the youngest, and the leader like the servant. And so as you and I look at what governance was intended to be in God's plan, if it's in keeping with God's will for you and I as believers, then the one who is in charge needs to be a servant. The one who is in charge needs to be like the youngest in the family. That doesn't mean rotten like Carol Teal was. It just means, I got some correction over here. But if you think about that whole process there, we are in fact, as Christians, serving one another. And by doing that, we serve Christ. Now, I remember a time, and I'm old as dirt, but I remember a time when a president got up and said, ask not what you can, what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. In that sense, then, the country was looking to its people for leadership and strength and accomplishment. And what you saw in that particular period of time was the ability to go to space, to go to the moon, and to do all those kinds of things as people were excited about making a contribution to their country's work rather than the fact that they were going to lean on their fence post and wait for a check. Now, some of you folks get a check and you absolutely deserve it. You're not getting what you deserve, because if you were getting better interest, you'd be getting a lot more money than you are now, so don't take that right. There are some people that are waiting for a check that need to be out working because they can. They need to be making sacrifices because that's the right thing to do. To better their family, to better their church, to better their community, and to do that as a service to God. Well, it goes on in verse 27. For who is greater, the one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? So the one who's being getting all the attention, right? It's supposed to be the one who's greater. Jesus says, but I am among you as the one who serves. Oh. So does Jesus still serve us today? Who's keeping you sane, by the way? That would be Jesus, right? Who is providing for every need that you have? Who is at work mediating between you and God the Father? Who is it that is doing all these things on your behalf? That would be Jesus. He's still working on our behalf in that way. So then he says, but I among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trial. Now he's speaking to his immediate His disciples, the apostles. And just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, I grant that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So I ask myself the question today, regardless of what's going on in the news, regardless of what's going on in the United States or France or Spain or wherever that you think about, am I standing with Jesus in the trials of the kingdom of God in this lifetime? Am I a part of suffering with other brothers and sisters in Christ that the name of Jesus might be lifted up, that people might be drawn to Him, that people might be saved? And so if I'm going to be a part of that, I would anticipate a role in the kingdom of God as well. Notice in verse 31, Simon, who is Simon Peter, Jesus says to him, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded permission to sift you like wheat. Is anybody feeling a little sifted? A little sifted? Maybe? Okay. Reality is that God permits. Now see, could Satan do the sifting of Simon in that passage without God's permission? No. He's demanded it. Which, I mean, if you can imagine. But it had to be granted. Why would God grant that? Well, let's talk about sifting. I mean, you know, the only sifting I've really ever been a part of is from a childhood was a flour sifter. You'd put it in there and you'd turn the little thing. And, you know, Mom would get finished and we'd grab it and chase each other around the house like it was a machine gun. You know, but you were trying to get things out of the flour that you didn't want in there. Well, go back. Historically, sifting wasn't to make the flour lose its lumps. Sifting was an actual process of trying to get chaff and weevils and everything else out that didn't belong there. And so God would allow a situation where Satan would be able to sift a person, might we say a nation, a church, that things that don't belong there would be come to the surface and could be removed. And so as we think about that, he says, but I have prayed for you. Does Jesus pray for you? As your mediator in heaven, does he stand before the Father mediating based on his blood sacrifice and who he is as the Lord of the church? Absolutely. He prayed for us in Scripture before we were ever born. He prayed for those who would be coming to him because of the witness of the earlier Christians. That's us. I pray for you that your faith may not fail. Now, in the process of being sifted, sometimes our faith struggles. Oh, what's going on? I don't understand what all this is about. And so as you look at it, that Peter was going to actually fail miserably in this situation of testing that he was about to go through. You see, the sifting was actually a test that he would go through. He said, and you, when once you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. Do you hear Jesus giving up on people? Do you hear him saying, well, you failed, you're inadequate, you should doubt whether or not you're really one of my disciples? No, you don't hear that. Look, there's the other screen. Isn't that wonderful, Mark? We have the other screen. And so, As you see this whole experience going on with Peter, it's not good to have the Lord look at you and say, you know, by the way, David, you are just really going to blow it this week, but once you've figured out what you've done and you've confessed that sin and repented and everything, I want you to go and help other people avoid that same crisis, that same situation. But then I would say, well, no, Lord, I couldn't talk to them anyway because they would think I'm judging them. Well, I couldn't talk to them because that might create a conflict. And so hence the church fails to do church discipline at the command of Jesus to support and encourage and help each other. And so instead of being sifted, we choose to hang on to the impurities rather than hurt someone's feelings. Even though what we're doing is loving and redemptive and caring and actually the command of Jesus himself. Well, he said to him, Lord, I am ready to go both to prison and to death. And he said, Peter, the rooster will not crow today until you have denied three times you even know me. Who knows our hearts better than God? And even though he knows the things that are there and the things that are wrong and the things that are he is going to change if we belong to him in that whole process, he doesn't give up. In fact, he patiently, lovingly points out the places that our weaknesses are and encourages us to be strengthened in his word and in the power of the Spirit, that we can grow beyond and be strengthened through these things. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, and that's kind of a big jump for y'all, but it says in this passage, as Paul speaks to Timothy, led of the Holy Spirit, first of all, then I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men. Okay, so prayers, just lifting the person up, petitions, specific requests, thanksgivings, things that we're thankful God has done, be made on behalf of all men. That includes who? For kings, for all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil, quiet life in all godliness and dignity. Now, you and I want to live a tranquil and godly life, and we may be concerned that if, in fact, the person who is being declared president-elect is officially in office and all those kinds of things, that greater persecution is going to come on the church. And I would say that's more than likely true, because we know what their political platform is, what they stood for, we know what they voted and done in the past. It would be consistent for them to do those things. And yet, as we pray, what is the result of our praying? What is the declaration that comes with this call to prayer? That we pray for kings and all in authority. It is so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. In fact, Jesus so intended us to grasp onto this idea that he said to pray for your enemies and those who despitefully use you. And so as we look at the idea of who Jesus was, did Jesus always, you know, just respond very sweetly to those who were his political opponents? And by the way, don't miss the point. If you've been reading that 40 Days book from Neil Mammon, don't miss the point that Pharisees and Sadducees were the local governance group. And Jesus was having to deal with politics because they had made the church, the temple, a political thing. And so he didn't talk to them about the politics. He talked to them about their motives. Right? He talked to them about their motives for what they did and why they did it. Well, you and I are going to deal with situations where we don't like some of the people, their motives, their plans, and all of those kinds of ideas, and yet we're being called upon to pray for those people. Now I'm going to make just a crazy statement, and I want you to grasp just the potential of it, okay? Could I make this statement that the Biden Harris ticket, if God allows them to step into actual government position, could be the best presidential team in the history of the United States if they were saved? He said, preacher, you slipped that last part in on it. If they were born again, if they were saved, if they were radically changed by the power of God, if they were walking in the Holy Spirit, if they were living by the Word of God, they could ultimately be the best presidential and vice presidential candidates we ever have. How do we get there? Well, I would say probably first that entreaties, prayers, petitions, thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men, for kings and those who are in authority. And why is that would be something that we would do? Well, I don't know about you, but I would love to live a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. So let's do it God's way. And let's see what God is going to do. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Now, on the other hand, coexist. Right? There it is. There is the agenda. You're going, that's just a little aside. No, that is the agenda. The agenda is not our presidential candidates. The agenda is one that is actually in the heavenlies. It's actually principalities and powers of darkness. And their goal, according to the book of Revelation, to what we see in 1 and 2 Thessalonians, is to institute a situation where we can have a global religion. And that's it. Do you see Islam? Do you see the Jewish David Star David? Do you see the yin and yang? Do you see the cross? And of course you have all the other things as well, including just the peace symbol, which is just kind of a new age hippie kind of thing, right? And so their goal is to force us to coexist. Now, I have a little thing I need to tell y'all. You see that cross at the end? It's going to drop off. I don't know how you want to say it, it coexists. It's going to drop off. And the Star of David is even going to come under great attack as well. And that is because they're based on faith in Yahweh God. Now, it's a mistaken faith. They missed the Messiah. The Jews are going to see that someday. They're going to respond to Jesus and they're going to be saved, and it's going to be an amazing thing to see. But you and I are going to coexist for the rest of our lives in this world. And so as we pray for each other, we pray for those in authority, you must understand that whichever group of people are in government, whichever group of people are running school boards, whichever group of people are running state governments, whoever it is, there are going to be people in there that have that as an agenda to push everything in this world to accept that first of all, there is no sin. Then there are the things that they disapprove of, and if you disapprove of their list, then cancel you. If you come up with something to say that you think it ought to be, then cancel you. And so that's how it's all going to work. So how are we going to deal with this? Folks, we as Christians, Jesus called us the salt of the earth, the light of the world. And that by the power of his spirit, I mean, Daniel, it comes out and clearly says that in the end times, there are going to be those who shine like the stars of the heavens in the midst of darkness. So there's going to be a battle, and it's going to be one that happens in your mind and in mine. It's going to be a battle in our hearts, whether or not to walk in the power of the Spirit, to anticipate that God is going to be leading us all away, that we're going to know that his plan is not for us to coexist. If you're taking notes, please write down these words. Say it really loud.
Exclusivity.
There you go, you heard it. Of the gospel. The gospel is exclusive. Whew. All right. It means that you can't have Jesus and. Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. John 14. And so whoever tells you you're going to work all that stuff in there and we're just going to all get along. See, last night I watched this, you know, just a young lady expressing her heartfelt things. It was on Channel 6, and she was talking about the fact that we would, because of the current administration, get to the place where we were no longer dehumanizing each other. That would go away. And I'm thinking, okay, first of all, I get the accusation toward me is that I am dehumanizing people because I do believe in there's a right and a wrong, and that God has determined it. And so there, in the being created in the image of God and living that out, says something about my sexuality and what's appropriate and not. It says something about all these areas of my life. And so to her, I dehumanize people by thinking that there's a lifestyle that is wrong, out a lifestyle that is right. God chose it. It's in here. And so they reinterpret this just like there are people in our world today that reinterpret the Constitution, that there's now a constitutional right to have child care, and there's a constitutional right to have a college education. There's a constitutional right to have an abortion. There's a constitutional right to have a living wage. And so the government should send you a paycheck. All of us should have a living wage because the government just, we have a constitutional right to that. And they got that in their head. It's not constitutional, nor is it true of Scripture that people simply have rights to have all of these things given. And so as you and I face this coexist process and this idea, how many of y'all really ever watched, I'm going to take my chances here, you really ever watched Star Trek? I know some of you don't, you're not Trekkies, but have you ever seen the show? Come on, you've seen it, okay. So I go over to this thing, and I walk up to it, and I say, hot tea, Earl Grey.
Earl Grey
hot. Yeah, open it, take it out, there you go. See, that's a trick. And so I sit down at my desk, and then somebody says, well, we need this and that and the other. Okay, photons, class four. I mean, there it is. And you can just make things appear atomically from nowhere in this show by talking to the wall. It's amazing. The problem with that is you have children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren that think the world can really work that way. You see, the government says you have to give this to these people, and I'm a manufacturer. I've got to buy supplies. I've got to buy resources. I've got to pay for all those things. Where does that come from? Well, we force those people to give you that. Well, where are they going to? Well, we're going to force those people to give it to them. Do you know how long a system like that works? Go back and study the history of the Soviet Union. It doesn't work well. And so you and I are going to have to realize that the world, listen to this, the world is now deceived. It is deluded. It has fallen into such a place of deception, it will not be retrieved. And as you and I live as salt and light in this world, as we represent Jesus, as we speak the gospel, we know that God has permitted, look at it, Romans chapter 1, when you get home, God turns this world over. That they're going to follow this whole coexist agenda. They're going to shove it down the throats of the world. And you and I, in the meantime, are loving people enough to share the gospel and praying for people in authority so that God knows I have done what God has given me to do. He didn't tell me to fix it. He told me to pray. Now, he has given me the, in the United States, the right to vote. And given that to the people in Saudi. Right? Hasn't given it to people in China, the right to vote? No. So I'm blessed, and I can take action there. Yesterday, I posted on Facebook, and I wasn't bragging. I guess I was just trying to stir up some encouragement. But I posted the fact that I sent $100 to Jay Sekulow over at the American Center of Law and Justice. Now, as much as I would say that I don't give a lot of money to political causes, I felt like that $100 was something that was really well given, because there was a brother in Christ who's trying to make sure that the election is actually presented as it was voted and not altered. Think about praying for people like that. all of these lawyers and people from the American Center of Law and Justice and our own legal services here at the church, ADF and folks like that. They're hard at work trying to protect our religious liberties and to make sure that what we are seeing in our lifetime and in our world is true. But notice in verse 4 of this passage, why does God have us doing this, praying? Well, God is the one who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Okay, so if everything is God's will, then everybody's going to be saved, because obviously if God wants it, that means it's got to happen. And there are some people who look at sovereignty in that way. There's one God, one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, a testimony given at the proper time. Today, if you do not have a saving relationship with Jesus, Jesus came, took our sin on the cross, physically died that we might be forgiven as we would put our faith and trust in him. He is in heaven today, standing as Satan accuses the children of God of all kinds of things. Jesus is there pleading his blood that was the sacrifice that covered our sin. Amen. In the midst of all of this, he gave his life as the ransom for all, a testimony given at proper time. There is not a person that God doesn't want to save. And so if you want to say, well, everything that happens is like it's God's will, I want you to look at this next passage. In Matthew 7, Jesus says, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who enter through it, for the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find it. If God wants everybody to be saved, then why aren't they? Ladies and gentlemen, God gave you a free will. Now, he didn't give you the will to choose how you want to be saved. He presented Jesus, and you can be saved by Jesus, or you can not be saved by Jesus. But you're not going to be saved any other way. There's no good deeds, there's no works, there's no sweet attitude, no nicest people you ever met. I've never known anybody sweeter in my life. Is Jesus there? Have they received Christ Jesus as their Lord and Savior? They acknowledged their sin to God, asked for forgiveness, and responded in belief to know Jesus and to be known by him. That's a narrow path. Well, God's sovereign will ultimately be accomplished. Yes. But you have to know what his sovereign will is, and you have to read the book. God wants people from every tongue, every tribe, every nation, every people group. He wants some from all of the folks that are possible. And you know what? He's going to have them. You see it in the book of Revelation. But you and I have a job to do. Because in the process of going through life and sifting things being sifted out of us by the work of the Holy Spirit that need to go, there's also some sifting that goes on as you and I go out and share the gospel of how people can be saved, and some people are going to respond. And from all the chaff and from all the rubble of all the people who are going to reject Christ, there are going to be those who will be saved. In Matthew 6, is a part of the Lord's Prayer. What does that have to do with the sovereignty of God? Pray then in this way. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed, holy, be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Why are we having to pray that the will of God would be done? Because of free will. Because there are people who are not going to do the will of God, and they are going to hurt other people. If you saw the thing that was acknowledged this past week, about the effect of communism on the world, 10 million people at least have been killed by the government-controlled group of communists. It was a socialist-based thing. I mean, the USSR is the United Socialist State of Russia. It's socialism. And so as you and I think about the fact that, yes, these evils are going to be here, they're going to come to an end. Which side are you going to be in on the meantime? Whose side are you going to be on? You remember when I said in John chapter 12 that the ruler of the age was going to be defeated by the cross. And the time would come that he would no longer be ruler of anything. Well, is that now? When is that coming? Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. If you know anything about the book of Revelation, it says, then the seventh angel sounded. Folks, the seventh trumpet is the last one. In the whole of the battles of everything that's going to happen in the end times, you have the seventh trumpet, and the seventh trumpet has seven bowls or vials, depending on which translation you have. And so this battle is going to go on, what I'm saying, in your lifetime and in mine. It's been going on since you were born. It was going on before you were born. It's been going on for thousands of years. It's been going on since the Garden of Eden. Now we need to make our decision, whose side are we on? Because as rough as it may get, as difficult as it could be, and as we pray for our enemies, and those who despitefully use us, as citizens, if we're called upon to defend our nation, as patriots, to do what is required of us as patriots, to take care of that work, whatever it might be, this is going to come to an end. You see what it says? There were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. You're going to see it. As a born-again child of God, you're going to hear those loud voices in the heavens. Who knows? That's probably Mark and a bunch of y'all, just loud people, you know? Loud voices in heaven! Hang in there. Remember, not even this election is finished. Not even on December the 13th. Who has veto power over everything on the earth? Is it your God? And if he doesn't veto something, is he capable of reaching into something even very tragic? Even judgment itself, is he able to reach into something like that for those who love him and bring out something to make us more like Jesus? Father God, thank you for this truth. We don't like dealing with conflict, and we don't like dealing with all these kinds of problems. We want to live that peaceful life. Lord God, we know that you know what's happening next. And so I think our peace is not based on our circumstances, really, but whether or not we're turning to you as the Prince of Peace in our own hearts. Whatever we're going to be called upon to do next, to stand up for the gospel, to love and care about people, each other, and those around us. Though we cannot do it in our own strength and power, we know we can do it as you live through us. So as your children today, Lord God, help us to lay before you right now all of our fears, all of our anxieties, all of our frustrations, that we might anticipate you got it, and you're going to help us through. Help us to make every use of the things that you've placed in our hands as citizens of this nation, even as you had Paul do the very same thing because of his situation. Lord, help us to trust in you ultimately from beginning to end. Lord, if there's someone here today who needs to respond to the gospel, to you, to your call in their life, that they would say, yes, Jesus, I believe in you. I trust in you to save me. I know I've sinned. I want to turn away from my life of sin. Jesus, would you come in? Forgive me of my sin. Change me. Please make me a child of God. Lord, as you've heard their prayer, and you know the sincerity and the truth of the things in their heart, we ask, Lord God, that you would save them. Lord, help them to proudly stand for you today and along with us for all the days ahead. And we would thank you for this, we do pray. In the name of Jesus. As we come to a time of invitation, maybe God's calling you to be a part of this church family. You can come and let me know. Maybe you prayed to receive Christ. Come and let me know. You need to follow the Lord in baptism. Whatever it is that God would have you come to pray at the altar, whatever it is, as we stand and as they're singing, this is your opportunity to respond. Even now, you come.
Dialysis or doctors, wherever it is that they, wherever they needed to go. They get ready to get on the bus and then say, Al, I can't go because I don't have the money. And I tell them, yes, you do. So they do have the money. And I thank this church family so much for helping me with that. It's really, that's why I'm not retired yet, because they need me. God, give me the power to stay with them. But I'm going to ask the preacher to go ahead and mention these names off. This is going to be our veterans. And guys, when you come up, and girls, just line up, and maybe before you leave, you want to come by and shake their hands, because they did sacrifice a lot. And I really never realized how much they sacrificed until I got older. And I, that's part of me too. But anyhow,
okay. I'm start the name. So, you're a veteran, we have your name on the list. If when we get to the end of this list, we haven't called your name, we would ask that you would please come anyway. Please stand at the front so we can acknowledge everyone at the end. These people have made a sacrifice for God and country, that your freedom, your First Amendment rights, your Second Amendment rights, you picked your amendment. They've defended it. And so we start with Billy Bickham, Army. Ronnie Denton, Army. Alfred Farwell, going to get his. Marine Corps. Jonathan Franks, Army. Marvin Funches, Marine Corps. George Getzler, Army. James Huselton, Air Force. James Matthew, Marine Corps. Dave McLennan, Army. I think you're going to have to wave at the camera. I think Dave is at the house there. Brian Patrick, Army. Kelly Patrick, Army. Thomas Phelps, Army. John Potter, Army. Manuel Ramon, Air Force. Floyd Reeves, Army. Benny Rose.
This fellow, excuse me, I'm sorry, but this fellow here is a Purple Heart recipient.
All right.
And he needs a little deserved, a little pressure there, really.
Benny Rose, Air Force. Basil Reisinger, Marine Corps. Alan Roberts, Army. Ernie Rodriguez, Army. William Sego, Army.
He might want to say a speech.
Donnie Council, CB. The last person in the room that wants to give a speech. Donnie Velasquez, Air Force. Harold Whitten, Army. Woody Woodard, Army. And if, even if you're a guest with us today, and you were in military service, if you would please come at this time as well.
I don't think this guy here knows if he was Air Force, Marine Corps, Navy. He's not sure. But this is your, these are your veterans. These are the ones that...
accepted as an offering to our heart, from our hearts to you. We ask now that nuggets of truth and wisdom that we receive today will be applied to our lives for your honor, for your glory, and your grace. We ask this, Lord, in your precious name. Amen. Amen.
Lord, we'll leave this end with the course with a solid rock. You will.